Hey, kids, we're a couple of annoyed grunt boys, and this is the 138th Simpsons Podcast. That's right, we're the podcast that explores the show The Simpsons from seasons 11 and beyond. Why 11 and beyond, you ask? Well, we know that there are plenty of other Simpsons podcasts that explore the quote-unquote golden age of The Simpsons, that's seasons 1 through 10, and we want to explore after that to find the gems that were hidden, or that we just didn't watch. We want to find what's good, what's bad, and what's scary. I am an annoyed grunt boy named Steve, and with me, as always, is...
CJ!
Hey, CJ, what's up?
Well, this is your first time listening. My name is actually Craig. I'm deciding to go by CJ. I think it's a cooler name. What do you think?
I support it.
I'm just going to stick with Craig.
Okay, Craig.
I'm making a reference to the episode coming up, maybe.
Whoa.
Yeah. You like how I'm connecting that?
That's pretty smart. I like it.
Thanks. Steve, I saw you had a busy weekend here in Portland. You were just peacefully having a peaceful prayer until Antifa and Black Lives Matter came and ruined your party. What's up with that?
Yeah, something like that.
If you guys didn't see the news, the Proud Boys were having a little religious party in the park. And some protesters took to the streets to get rid of them because they're Nazis.
Yeah, that's all that they are. Plain and simple, Nazis.
Yeah, if you see anyone on Twitter saying it was a peaceful protest of a religious thing. No. Proud Boys are Nazis. They're just right. Bad.
Right. Not a political podcast. No. And we don't need to get into this, but Antifa isn't a real thing. Like, there are people who are anti-fascist, but
yeah, which we all should be.
Right. Exactly. Also, Portland's not. It never was on fire. It's all fine.
We're saying the same things we said a year ago.
Yep.
And we're going back to mask mandates because people just can't get it together. Oh, man, Steve, why are we starting this way? Gosh, I blame me because I was trying to make a joke that you were a Proud Boy.
Just because I have the haircut doesn't make it so. I mean, I guess I don't have the haircut anymore because usually when you think of racist, you think of now people with tight Nazi haircuts, not just bald men. So
right.
That's good.
And we all know you weren't in Portland this weekend. You were in Colorado watching a Colorado's Rocky game. Where, unfortunately, you were calling for the mascot of the Rockies, but the internet thought you were saying a racist slur.
Yeah, it was just calling for the guy.
The mascot of the Rockies' name is Dinger. And, like, you know, when you hit a dinger, like, that's a good thing, you know?
Yeah.
But on the TV, we just heard something else.
A different word. Yeah.
But later, the Rockies and the person who said it was confirmed. So that was you, Steve.
That's right. Just saying dinger.
Yeah. It wasn't Steve, but I saw that news story. I'm like, oh, this is weird. And then I just thought, like, this is like Larry David Curb Your Enthusiasm moment, isn't it?
It absolutely is. Like, I was saying dinger.
I really should have started a Twitter account 10 years ago that it would have been like Curb Your Enthusiasm ideas, because I get them all the time in my head, like not an actual episode, you know, scripted out or whatever, or, you know, they make an outline and then they improv. But I've always thought of there could be a whole season just based on like quarantine. I'm sure. I know, like, they said they're going to do an episode that deals with it, but not the whole season.
Yeah.
I think we've talked about it before, like an episode where Larry is this a Curb Your Enthusiasm podcast?
Actually, I think it might be a Simpsons podcast.
Yeah, let's just talk about Curb for a second.
Okay.
You know, where Larry like cords N95 masks or the toilet paper thing. I don't know. I had another idea where like Leon, played by JB Smooth, I think they still live together, right?
I think so, yeah.
Here's an idea, right? Larry has to go to a doctor's appointment, but his car's in the shop, right?
Mm-hmm.
And meanwhile, it's set up like, here's the Chekhov's phaser or gun, as we like to call it. Leon starts doing like working as a ride share, like an Uber or Lyft. And so Larry casually just asked Leon, like, hey, can you take me to the doctors? And Leon's like, sure. And they get the doctors. Then Leon, like, all right, that's, you know, give me your card. I'm charging you.
Yeah.
And then they get like, what do you mean charge? You just taking me. You're my, you know, roommate or whatever. There's that. That could be something, right? What do you got for me?
Like, I could see like maybe Richard Lewis is like a bad mask wearer.
Like his outfits.
Exactly. So he has like a black mask that is four sizes too big.
Just like dangles.
Exactly. It's not even that he's like against it. It just hangs around his neck. And like, Larry gets frustrated with him by that.
You know what it could be too? Is like maybe it's like so big and dangles. But like he also is like wearing like a big floppy black hat or something. Like people think he's like a Muslim woman. I've been rewatching Curb. So that's what's on my mind.
It's always fun.
It's always fun and sunny in Philadelphia.
Hey, ooh, speaking that's of about which, a bar.
It is about a bar. Patties.
Yeah. And you know what's great? Hamburger patties. When you're at a barbecue, and you know what's great at a barbecue? Beer.
especially a BYOBBB party.
Exactly. That last B is a typo.
I guess you could have just stopped at the Patties, but I get the joke now.
Speaking of jokes, comedians are often alcoholics, and sometimes they like to drink beer, which means it's time for our favorite segment, the Simpsons Beer Corner. Craig, what have you got for us this week?
All right, I tried to find one of the beers that I just recently purchased to connect with this episode, but I didn't.
That's okay.
I couldn't find a fermented caper brews, and I'm glad I didn't. So we're just going to go with, I'm feeling very stouty today, Steve. We're going to the North Coast Brewing Company, which is based out of Fort Bragg, California.
Classic.
One of their beers, they have the stouts is the Old Rasputin, Steve.
Yes.
The barrel age Old Rasputin Russian Imperial Stout. I've never actually had this.
Ooh.
This one.
Yeah.
But because it's the 23rd, I guess that's what they call it. So this is their 23rd batch, I guess you would call it.
Yeah.
Of the Old Rasputin. Steve, I'll let you know that it comes in at a nice, cool bottle.
Ooh.
It has the alcohol volume is 11.4%. So they say they age the batches in their much beloved Russian Imperial Stout in a bourbon and rye whiskey barrels for this 23rd release. The depth, intensity, and complex of the flavor profile of this special release, like its predecessors, may make it worthy tribute to Old Rasputin. I feel like I'm a copywriter reading this. Writing copy is not fun. I just hated it. Anyways, I digress. Steve, so apparently it's let me just open it and find out.
That's the best you can do.
Yeah, it's a stout, guys. It's dark. You know, there's probably hints of malt.
Some maybe coffee notes.
Coffiness, yeah. It does say that the beer does finish well with notes of raisins and berry-like fruits.
Yeah.
All right. I opened it with a bottle opener. You know how, like, when you wine taste and you smell it first? I do that with beer. Is that fine?
No, I recommend that people do that. That's great.
I am actually getting those raisins, like, almost you're smelling a bran muffin.
Sure. That flavor profile is exactly what I want out of a stout in most foods. And yeah, in life. I love that.
Like it does have that, like, almost like a raisin bran kind of smell too.
Yeah, that dark kind of fermenty,
yeah,
oaty flavor.
Enough of smelly.
Doesn't smell like a dog who's been to Abu Dhabi.
I don't like Odie. It was a really bad Garfield Lorenzo music impersonation. You know what's great about it too is, like, yeah, I'm getting those aftertastes, but like the whiskey does come through with these, and that's what I love about them.
Yeah.
Not bitter, although they say the IBUs is 38, which is kind of low.
Yeah,
it's getting into the high territory there, but I don't really taste it.
Sounds like an incredible beer.
Yeah, this is a good one. I think I'm drinking in the wrong season.
Mm-hmm.
There is some, you know, stouts that I will drink in the summertime, but this is definitely, like, I need this in fall and winter, like, because you get that aftertaste and you get that head warmth of, like, after you take, like, a shot of whiskey, you know.
Yeah.
This is I think the alcohol is getting right to me. It's gonna be a fun one, Steve. I recommend the Old Rasputin. It's available a lot of places, so check it out. Go to northcoastbrewing.com. Find out where you can get your barrel-aged Old Rasputin. I don't think it's very kid-friendly. It looks like a bottle of beer, so good job for not making kids attracted to it.
Yeah.
Plus, you got a scary old man on it, Rasputin. He had a huge hog, right?
I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Okay, cool. Speaking of huge hogs, Steve, what are you drinking?
Doesn't play that I have a hog or that I'm going to have. So full disclosure, what I'm drinking today isn't technically a beer.
Did I do that once?
I think you might have, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I drink my father's root beer.
Yeah. All the rage these days with the kids who are old enough to drink is the flavored seltzers, your White Claws, your Topo Chicos, your Trulies, and some craft brewers are getting into the game. And as you know, I like to try whenever I can to associate my beverage with the episode that we're going to watch. And so this is a collaboration with Pulpit Rock Brewing and Untitled Art, which is a microbrewery out of Wanaki, Wisconsin, so nowhere local. But this is an imperial seltzer that is strawberry shortcake. It is gluten-free. It is vegan. The artwork is looks like modern art, so I don't think kids would... Actually, looks like a kid may have drew it. No offense to Stephanie Heyman, the artist of the can, which they actually... Apparently note on the can. So yeah, it comes in at 9%. So for a seltzer, most seltzers are solidly at 5%. So to have one at 9.
Pretty fun, yeah.
Pretty fun, yeah. So it is a strawberry shortcake imperial seltzer. It's a very deep, like red kind of color, like almost that of a rhubarb. Ooh, I smelled it. Smells very strong, very much like strawberry, like those strawberry candies that people always have, but nobody's ever purchased.
I love them.
You know what I'm talking about? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That look like strawberry wrap. The wrappers look like strawberries. Yeah.
Precisely. Oh, yeah. That's exactly what it tastes like.
Nice.
Oh, man. It's actually candy.
I'm a fan of those candies, too.
Yeah. This is dangerous.
It's almost like those Fruitlies that I had last week. That was
that's exactly what I was thinking about. Yeah.
Which
yeah,
I actually picked up some more of those. Those are good.
Very nice. Yeah. This is a very, very drinkable, even though it is 9% alcohol. But yeah, most of those seltzer I've tried, I don't like. Because they don't have much flavor. Mm-mm. And I'm somebody who enjoys drinking sparkling water, like a LaCroix or whatever, on the regular basis. And it messes with my head because it's like what I drink when I'm not drinking. So if I'm drinking it to get drunk, then what am I doing with my life? Yeah. But this doesn't taste just like that at all. It tastes like strawberry shortcake. Like it's got a rich, bright strawberry flavor and then a creaminess to it that I think is probably a little bit of vanilla or something, but I highly recommend it.
It's because I'm not a big seltzer guy because of, I think I want more of like the flavory. Mm-hmm. So you think I'd probably like this one more than like a regular, because I don't like those LaCroix or I don't like any of the White Claws or anything like that. You think I would like this then?
Yeah, this is on another level. This is very strong. I think both you and Heather really enjoy it.
I will definitely check that out. Where can I buy that, Steve?
You can buy it at World Foods on 9th and Everett in Portland, Oregon.
Yeah, but where can I buy it?
Oh, you can go to untitledart.com, maybe.
I'll figure it out. I guess the listener have to figure it out too.
Yeah.
All right, Steve, I think it's time to jump into a time machine and go back in time.
All right. Let's go all the way back to, let's say, 2014, March 23rd, to be exact. What was the number one movie in the box office?
It was Divergent, which I was until I was 18 years old. Divergent.
Exactly.
That's one of those YA post-apocalyptic type movies, right?
Yep, it's The Hunger Games, but it's not The Hunger Games.
Yeah, part of that kind of craze that was going on at that time with like the Twilights, The Hunger Games. I'll let you know I didn't see it or read the books.
No, I just did enjoy the series because there's Divergent, Insurgent, and The Urgent Pervert. Allegiant. There it is. So Divergent, Insurgent, and Allegiant.
I was a fan of the fourth film where Detergent, where they were just doing laundry. It was really good.
Yeah, good clean fun.
They got those streaks out of those underwears really well. Steve, while we were diverging from the theater, from that movie, what were we listening to on our transistor radio?
Well, we were listening to the number one song on the Billboard Hot 100, Happy by Pharrell Williams.
Now, we've had this a couple times on this podcast. We've probably played the original. We've probably played the Kids Bop. Mm-hmm. I've said before, this song doesn't make me happy. It just makes me sad. So I did some deep dive in on YouTube. By deep dive, I mean, I just typed in happy metal cover.
Oh, fun.
And the very first one that came up was from a band called UMC. UMC stands for Ultimate Music Covers. They make a mix, essentially. And so it's still Pharrell singing, but then they play their metal guitars and drums over it. So I think it might make me a little bit more happier. In fact, we might play it a little bit longer than usual songs, because I want to see if it makes Steve happy.
All right.
Steve,
that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, that does make me happy.
Yeah, it was very well done. I too am happy.
I think I'll have to look up UMC more if they do the songs, you know, that are the number one hits, because honestly, I think that version is way better than the original one.
Yeah, and it melds so well. Like, it was a very smooth edit.
It bops, is what the kids like to say.
It indeed does bop.
it makes me like that song more.
Me too. I'm not since Weird Al covered it have I thought about how much I like that song.
He covered it?
He did Tacky, I think.
No, should have played that. Oh, he should start playing. Well, I guess he still does the covers. Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
What's this episode that we're talking about watching?
So we're talking about the 15th episode of the 25th season, The War of Art, in which Marge and Homer buy a painting at the Van Houtens yard sale, and the couples find themselves at odds when the painting turns out to be worth a lot of money.
Wow. All right.
All righty. Let's watch that episode, and then we'll talk about it. We'll be right back. Today we're talking about The War of Art, the 15th episode of the 25th season. It originally aired on March 23rd, 2014. It is episode 545 in the show's run. Your nerd code is SABF10. It was written by Rob LaZebnik, directed by Stephen Dean Moore, and your showrunners are Al Jean and Matt Selman.
All right, Rob LaZebnik, what can we say that we've never said about him before?
His wife, Claire LaZebnik, is an author.
We haven't talked about some of his other TV shows, I don't think.
Oh.
Like, for instance, his first big show was Empty Nest.
Oh.
Ran from 88 to 95.
Classic NBC Friday night television program up against, or on the same night as Golden Girls.
Yeah. Starred Richard Do-Over. I'm sorry, Richard Mulligan.
Yes.
Tells the day-to-day misadventures of a widowed pediatrician named Harry Weston, played by, of course, the aforementioned Richard Mulligan, and his two adult daughters, Barbara and Carol, who've come back to live with him after failed marriages. I get this confused with the Burt Reynolds show. What was that?
Oh, the one with Delta Burke.
Yeah.
Evening Shade.
Evening Shade.
I don't like how quickly I pulled that out of my ass. I did not use the internet for that. That ran from 1990 to 1994. And that's for former professional baseball player Woodrow Wood Newton retires to his hometown of Evening Shade, Arkansas, and gets a job as a coach of a high school football team with a long losing streak. Huh.
I don't think that's the show I'm thinking of then.
Oh, that has Burt Reynolds, Mary Lou Henner, Michael Jeter, and some other people.
Do you think Mary Lou Henner remembers anything about filming that show?
Probably not. She probably just like drank it away. Like, I hate my powers. Burt's so weird.
Mary Lou Henner, what happened to you on April 7th, 1982? Well, I ate a ham sandwich. Yeah. Oh my God, she knows.
The secret is she has a ham sandwich every day.
Yeah. And she's a vegetarian. No, there was an Empty Nest, Evening Shade. Wasn't there another one about, what's the one with the empty nesters? No, you know, the one where it's, maybe it was Empty Nest. Was there another show that Burt Reynolds was starred in?
Thought so.
Maybe it was just Evening Shade. Huh. All right. Well,
I could have sworn, though, that I thought he was one with Delta Burke, but they're just saying Evening Shade.
Yeah, he was in that. I guess I'm just, maybe I'm just crossing the shows.
It's possible that they were like maybe syndicated next to each other or something, and you watch them
like,
in succession.
And then there was also the Bob Uecker show. Well, that was Mr. Belvedere.
Yeah, he sat on his balls.
Who tells that story? Look it up, someone.
Yeah, it's an old Hollywood joke, kind of like the Who Jackie joke.
Yeah. So Rob LaZebnik created a show called Common Law, starring Greg Giraldo.
Did we come up with that show?
No, it was like, because Greg Giraldo, he's a comedian who also went to school to be a lawyer. But it's like literally the story of Common Law is the same as, it's just Greg Giraldo's like, he's like a comedic lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
Only lasted 4 episodes, Steve.
No.
But there's like a promo image on IMDb that just looks so 90s, like sitcom promo.
Yeah,
image.
just the name of it, Common Law, just seems like something that we'd think of.
Yeah. But it wasn't us. It was Rob LaZebnik, the writer of this episode. That's what we're talking about. Rob.
That's right. And so for some trivia for you, the episode name is a reference to the book, The Art of War by Sun Tzu.
Steve, have you read The Art of the War?
No, I prefer The Art of Peace. By Moon Zoo. I don't know.
Okay. Steve, let's do our usual chalkboard gag and all that stuff here.
Well, our episode begins with no title gag, no bully board gag, no chalkboard gag, and no couch gag. Like somebody who's adept at oral sex, there's no gag at all. This is the 12th episode to not have any sort of gags. And yeah.
You're right. This is the 12th episode to have no gags.
I mean, no opening gags.
Oh.
They probably put some layered in throughout the episode, but the traditional ones like your couch or your chalkboard, not so much.
There are gags. Let me know. I haven't seen them yet.
Okay. I mean, the font of The Simpsons is kind of funny. It's all yellow.
Ooh, yeah.
Kind of wiggly.
Yellow's a funny color.
Yeah.
Big Bird, he's yellow.
Peepee.
Yeah. Well, I guess that means with no gag, Steve, that The Simpsons wants to be a long episode.
I think it might be, or at least it'll feel like it. Maybe. Yeah,
maybe. So Homer's in the bathroom there. That's how the show starts, like every episode, Homer in the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
And he sees a series of post-it notes, trademark post-its, of course, that read Lisa, and then one under that says wants, another that, and then dot, dot, dot. And then Homer finds the words guinea pig written in toothpaste.
Hmm.
That's a waste of toothpaste, Lisa.
It really is.
And it's a bitch to clean, like, toothpaste.
Yeah.
Don't you hate it when you get, like, one speck of toothpaste on your shirt before you leave, and you're like, fuck.
It's
you,
so
you
annoying.
Can't wear it. You can't wear it. Yeah. You gotta change.
Especially if you're wearing a dark shirt, because you can't. Yeah. Yeah, your day's ruined.
You know what, Steve? I'll let you know that usually I brush my teeth in the shower.
That's good. I do that from time to time.
And I still have my clothes on.
Yeah. He's always ready to go. That way, if you spill any toothpaste on your shirt, you just wash it off under the shower. You got soap there.
Exactly.
No laundry.
No. So anyways, it's Marge's time to clean up there. So she's in the shower. But then she's stunned to find that someone's written guinea pig using the condensation on the glass there.
Huh. That'd be creepy.
Especially Homer... so Lisa then had to write it backwards, right?
That's true.
And it looks really good for writing in backwards.
Yeah. Unless she wrote it beforehand in the shower.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe. I don't
yeah,
know.
Yeah. No, that would. But because you could also do from the other side if it's foggy. So why was Lisa then showering in their bathroom?
I think she just woke up early that morning, got some post-it notes, wasted some toothpaste, and then wrote in the shower.
Oh, wow. It.
All right.
Did she already have that written there when Homer took a shower? Was it established that he took a shower?
Yeah, I think so. Because, yeah, He probably just maybe didn't notice it. Maybe he's too busy washing his balls.
Do you think Homer has like four pubes that look like his hair, like on each testicle?
And then just one rib, like stripy yeah. ribbon across. Maybe, with yeah.
MG on it. Hey, listeners, if you like to draw fan art, draw us a picture of Homer's balls and send it to us at steve@gmail.com.
Yes, stevejobs@gmail.com. Homer then heads to work. Outside of the power plank, we see that his parked car has been adorned with guinea pig stickers. Then in section 7G, several photos and drawings of guinea pigs are covering Homer's workstation. Lenny and Carl step in, both wearing shirts with guinea pigs on them, and tell Homer about the little rodents and how they're self-groomers and jump straight up when they're excited, which is known as popcorning. Homer knows who's behind this. It's Lisa. He then receives a text from her, which is just a series of guinea pig emojis. Emojis! Now she's gone too far. Homer and Marge sit down to have a discussion about Lisa's new obsession.
Lisa, your father and I are very concerned about all this hinting.
I've never had a pet of my very own. My clock is ticking. I don't want to be one of those girls who waits till she's 16 to decide if she's ready and then it's too late.
Well, we've talked about it. And if you really want a guinea pig, you'll have to sign this contract.
I, Lisa Simpson, hereby promise to take full responsibility for this dog, cat, other.
Circle other.
This includes feeding, bathing, cleaning of droppings and barfings, and when the time comes, burying or flushing.
Boilerplate, boilerplate, boilerplate. We can skip all this litter box stuff. If pet becomes internet superstar, all rights revert to father. Sign here, here, initial here, one more over here, and done.
Thank you.
The kid-parent contract. Unenforceable, yet you feel like you didn't completely cave.
I know they showed pictures of Homer's office many times. There's, you know, control panel.
Mm-hmm.
I just wish sometimes they would reference the famous Do It For Her collage that he has from the episode. They never show that again. That's all I just wanted to say. Like, just throw it out there once in a while, guys.
Yeah, it'd be nice. It'd be a nice little Easter egg there.
Yeah, fans like that crap.
Yeah. Guinea pigs, Craig.
Yeah, we've talked about them before.
Yeah, I figured we have.
If anyone doesn't know, we never had guinea pigs. Wait, did you? Wait, you did.
No, I had hamsters. I had a friend who had a guinea pig, and I'd stay over at his house on some weekends. And it was annoying because the guinea pig would run on its wheel all night long. And yeah, you just hear that squeaking all night long.
And my hamsters would do that too, and I hated it.
Yeah.
This is weird, this episode. Like, Lisa just all of a sudden wants a guinea pig.
Yeah.
Just trying to think. Then they have this like whole contract, right?
Right.
And it's weird too, like that. Well, they have a cat and a dog. Were they ever like thinking that like Lisa just wanted a dog or a cat to her own self?
I guess. Yeah. I mean, that's what's kind of stated in the contract.
Hmm.
But I know it's not, but I always kind of felt like Snowball too was kind of Lisa's cat.
Yeah.
Because I always figured Santa's little helper is Bart's.
Wait a minute. And she's also had like a hamster before.
Yeah.
It's like the same thing.
Pretty much. She had a horse for a little while too.
Right. What else does she have? Didn't she have to take care of like a turtle? Or no, she had to take care of what was the one episode we watched where she had to take care of a hamster, right? That one.
Yeah, it was the Richard Gere episode. It was. It was the one where Lisa becomes a Buddhist.
Wasn't there one where she was adopting a bunch of pets and was neglecting a hamster too?
That's the one where Bart is a drummer. Yeah.
What?
The one with the white stripes.
Bart was just a drummer. She didn't have to take care of a hamster, did she?
There was a B story, because I remember her walking down the street to Little Green Bag, or the song from Reservoir Dogs. And I remember that scene, and there's like animals around her. And yeah.
Wow. There's just
it all starts to bleed together.
Yeah. All right. Well, after that clip there, Homer then tosses that contract. And the family leave the Springfield city limits and enter Crystal County, home of the meth high fighting tweakers.
A little trivia. We see the Simpsons car and their license plate is 1PHL07, which is not the nerd code, although it looks like it could be. But that was first shown in the Simpsons movie and has appeared on screen as the Simpsons license plate number several times since then.
Yeah, we talked about this podcast a two or go. Maybe it was last week. I forget. Again, it all bleeds together. We had a theory that in each episode, the nerd code was on a car. Because we've been seeing them lately, but I guess maybe not this episode.
Yeah.
Do you know what that is? That a code for something? 1PHL07?
Not that I'm aware of, but I did very little research and I could not find anything. But maybe I'll look a little bit more at some point.
You could do it in 4 weeks and come back to us and let us know.
4 weeks. You got it. Recording or from air date?
Air date.
Okay. So
get more time.
Yeah, thank you. So the family then arrive at the Guinea Pig Rescue and Adoption Center. And below that sign is a sign that reads caveat emptor. And this is a very like high-minded joke because it's a pun on the word cavy, C-A-V-Y, which is another term for guinea pig. And then the Latin phrase caveat emptor, which is the principle that the buyer alone is responsible for checking the quality and sustainability of goods before a purchase is made. Or to put it more simply, buyer beware, which is a good thing to have, you know, if you're selling pets, because pets are animals and animals get sick.
Is this on the same level as the famous Chuck's formerly known as Chuck's feed?
Yeah, cheats. Yeah, Sneed's seed and feed.
Yeah.
Formerly Chuck's. Yeah, this is almost as good. Slightly less dirty. So inside, the Simpsons find cage after cage of guinea pigs and a kindly old woman wearing a guinea pig sweatshirt.
You're doing the right thing adopting a rescue pig. You know, most of these guys are rejects from the big guinea pig mills in the Midwest. Oh, I can't tell you how many mill pigs we get in here who have bumblefoot or the slobbers.
You don't have children, do you?
This one whistled at me.
Ooh, that could be the one.
Oh, but that orange guy looks like a pumpkin.
But this fellow is so fuzzy.
Well, they all have their charms.
This one's nibbling a sunflower seed. Look at that hair. Oh, I just want to comb it forever.
Have you seen a pinker nose?
Oh, I have now.
Lisa, you've just got to choose one. Lisa?
She's gone, honey. She's gone.
That one's fur looks like a tuxedo.
A Band-Aid on its tail. Oh.
Albino!
I know this is a podcast. So she was actually talking about Steve at the end there, not a hamster.
Yeah. They just saw me and like, oh my God, it's Powder.
Sean William Scott? I mean, no. Jan Michael Vincent? No.
Tiffany Amber Thiessen.
Sean Patrick O'Flannery. That's who it is.
Yeah.
Young Indiana Jones himself.
Mm-hmm.
I find the Homer's joke is a little insensitive. Not insensitive. Well, yeah, I guess I'll be nice about that. Like,
yeah.
Oh, because she's a crazy guinea pig lady. She doesn't have kids.
She's just passionate about something.
Yeah. And I don't like that whole like, if you don't have kids, then you're missing out on life.
Oh, believe me. This is a thing that Laura and I, my wife, have had to deal with a lot because we are very adamantly of not having kids.
Yeah.
And like Laura has to deal with it a lot more than I do because women normally traditionally have the children. But like they always
ask. 2022, Steve.
they always ask Laura, like, well, what does your husband think about you not having kids? It's like, I agree. Yeah. Why we worked together, we talked about it, and I think kids are dumb. And my kid would especially be dumb because would only watch The Simpsons and drink coffee all day.
And then when he's old enough, 7, he'll be drinking whiskey.
Exactly. It would just turn out just like me.
Well, you were like 5 when you started drinking whiskey.
Yeah.
You'd be a better parent that way.
I was, I showed promise at an early age.
And we're overpopulated as it is, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Listeners, if you want to have kids, but probably don't.
What if they already have them, Steve?
Well, you know what to do.
You know what to do.
Love your children.
Right. All right. Hey, so Lisa, she's all excited. She wants all those guinea pigs, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'll probably die within a week anyway. Doesn't matter. So she's running around, Lisa, fall in love with each of the new guinea pigs she sees there. And the rest of the Simpsons are sitting, waiting, getting a little tired and impatient. Oh, that must be how our listeners feel. Yeah. So then the night falls and Lisa still debates with herself about which pig is perfect. And, they close. So they have to head over to a hotel, which is perfectly conveniently right next door to the sanctuary called the W Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
A play on the famous W hotels. Isn't there a difference between hotel and motel? Isn't a hotel the indoor hallways?
Yeah, a motel or a motor hotel is the kind with the exterior entryway.
Yeah, that looks like
Simpsons have.
Yeah, it looks like a motel right there.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Is that a blunder in your opinion, since you worked in the hospitality industry?
I mean, kind of, but I was thinking about it. If a motel is just a motor hotel, then wouldn't all motels technically be hotels still? Just it's like how all rectangles or how all squares are rectangles, but right. Not all rectangles are square. I don't know.
I mean, I just it's, because the joke is the W hotels. I don't think there's the W motels.
No.
And most people don't really distinguish the motel and the hotel.
So what you're saying is whoever wrote these notes is just being pedantic and pointless.
Yes. Who wrote the notes for this episode that we're reviewing, not who wrote the episode.
Exactly. Yeah.
a funny joke, though, because they're in the country in W.
Yeah. So the Simpsons head back, and the next morning, Lisa is reviewing photos from Homer's phone of the rodents. They then head back to the adoption center, and Lisa's found the one, a cute tan guinea pig with a little white face. This is a guinea pig that'll make her happy. Homer is cautiously optimistic, thinking Lisa has finally decided. He tells Bart and Marge to keep quiet so they don't blow it. That sad, sweet woman then asks Lisa if she only wants one, as they do tend to do better in pairs. Lisa is excited at the prospect of 2 new pets, but Homer quickly picks her up, throws her in the car, and while shouting, "Fighting Tweaker's rule," they drive off.
So back home, Lisa's trying to give her new friend Pokey a perfect replica of his natural habitat. He has a Peruvian feather grass, an Incan sleeping mat, and a portrait of Marisol Espinosa, the first female vice president of Peru. And this is, when Bart points out, this is actually an ideal habitat for Lisa. And so they notice that all of a sudden Pokey's gone.
Pokey. Oh, no.
Pokemon gone.
Pokemon no to the polls.
What?
Like Hillary Clinton. During the 2016 election, she was like trying to get the youth vote. So she said, stop playing Pokemon Go and play Pokemon Go to the polls.
Oh, yeah, because that was popular then.
Right.
All right. That's why she didn't win,
The only reason. There were a lot of Yu-Gi-Oh fans voting that year. Is that a thing? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
Lisa and Bart scour the house looking for the rodent and then spot him in the living room. Bart goes for the fireplace tongs to grab a furry little creature, but Lisa pushes her brother to the ground and Pokey steps over his head and runs to a very cartoony hole in the wall. Lisa presses her ear to the wall and hears chewing, but that's not the chewing of a guinea pig. It's the chewing of a human pig. Homer Simpson, to be exact, who is sitting in the kitchen enjoying the heroine of the farmer's market, kettle corn.
I know Homer's done this before, or like in comedy has done before, but it's just so weird that Homer's, usually when he makes these dumb jokes, he's with somebody, right? Like yeah. He's just sitting by himself eating kettle corn. He's like, kettle corn, the heroine of farmer's market. I'm like, who's he saying this to? Was I weird? Am I the only one who's weird?
No, that is weird. I think last week we talked about the laughing of jokes in sitcoms and such. And this is one of those instances where, yeah, he's just.
But he comes up with that joking because he does laugh at himself.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? I do that because I'll think of something stupid and like say it out loud.
Yeah, I do it all the time.
Yeah, never mind. But is it the heroine of farmer's market, Steve? In my opinion, it's the heroine is the heroine of the farmer's market.
Yeah. I always think of kettle corn. I know you get them at farmer's markets, but I always think of it more of a carnival food.
Yeah.
And then, you know, meth is the heroine of carnivals.
Yeah. I think it's like, I'll go to farmer's markets, but I think for me, it's always like try our barbecue sauces. Like the samples, and then you always feel obligated to buy it and then you never use it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I remember buying like the salsa mix, trying like, oh, this is good. And I think we made it once. Which is literally it's just the, you know, the seasoning, and you just mix it with a can of diced tomatoes and that's it.
Yeah. I mean, that sounds good, but yeah, it's really, I remember a couple years ago, Laura and I took a trip to New Mexico and we visited a farmer's market there, and all the cuisine obviously is Mexican inspired, but the New Mexico is always red or green chili sauce on almost everything. And we really like the red sauce. So you buy the chili powder, and we bought $40 of it, and it came in a brick. Like a red brick. And Laura had it in a Ziploc bag and it was totally worth it. But when we were leaving to go home, we got stopped. She got stopped by the police, or not by the police, but you know, the TSA or whatever.
Yeah.
Cause they like scanned her backpack or her luggage.
Yes.
And there's a large brick of powder in there. And so we're held up for like 15 minutes while they found out, oh, nope, just going to make some enchiladas later. No cocaine.
In reality, it was a brick of cocaine. It just, spray painted it.
Yeah, it just throws the scent off. It's like coffee.
Yeah.
If you mail coffee, nobody notices the weed that you're also mailing.
Yeah.
Which is why for years I've said that I really love coffee, when really I don't care about coffee. I love getting high. I have a really good drug cartel.
But it's marijuana. We can just get that now legally, Steve.
I know.
Time to up your drug game, because, you know, as we know, marijuana is a gateway drug.
That's right. I'm going to start selling PCP.
All right. It sounds good to me. All right. Well, back to the Simpsons, Steve. Lisa declares that she's lost her guinea pig when all of a sudden she hears some squeaking. And above the couch, we see a little tiny nose poke out from the beloved Simpson sailboat painting that Marge painted and has many replicas herself. Pokey pokes his nose and the rest of his body through that artwork. And Lisa's pleased to have her friend back. But Marge isn't happy there.
Before we go to that clip, two things. I really like the sound of the guinea pig. I think they made the right choice. Mm-hmm. It kind of reminded me of Kirby from Kirby's Adventure from the NES.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the guinea pig acted very animalistically, like just like an animal. It didn't, you know, have any personality. And so I thought Matt Groening would appreciate that.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
He didn't fire Rob LaZebnik that week.
Yeah, not this time, LaZebnik. You got lucky.
All right, well, here's the clip that Steve promised you all.
Our boat painting!
I'm sorry, Mom.
That's okay, sweetheart. Your pig thingy didn't mean it. It's just, it felt comforting to know that while we watched TV, there was art going on behind us. Well, I guess we have to go to an art gallery and buy a new painting.
Sure, we could go to a fancy gallery and spend a bunch of money, or...
I like Marge's logic. Like, oh, the painting's ruined. And we'll forget about the fact that she has a closet full of them. But that now you have to go to an art museum and buy art. You can't just go buy a print or, you know.
I think that might be the joke, right?
Yeah.
She just assumes that you go to a museum to get your paintings.
Yeah, that's where the art is.
I say home is where the art is.
I like that.
This is like a thing you would get at Target in the decor section.
Home is where the art is.
Which leaves, I hope that works, because then I would put the F in front of the art.
Yeah.
Oh, I do like Marge's quote there of, and she was saying when they're watching TV, she likes the idea that there's art behind them.
Marge, that's disrespectful to the medium of TV. Yeah. There's art happening in front of you, too.
And as someone who's on TV, she should know better.
Yeah. She probably just sees it as work.
That's true. You know, a lot of those actors out there, they're like, oh, I don't watch my performances. You just know Marge, like, after she's done on the set of The Simpsons, she heads home and, you know, probably gets a nice bottle of wine. Mm-hmm. You know, she's got her servants. I'm not sure if the Marge actress is married or not.
She strikes me as a single lady.
Yeah, she's probably not cool at all.
No, probably kind of. I see her like chain smoking and like, yeah, just being rude to the help.
Yeah, I've never seen Marge like on other shows. Like, I've never seen her act in other things. Like, what is she like? Like, can she not play like a mom, like in a TV show or movie? Like, maybe she's like a, I don't know. She could have been great as Tanya's mom in I, Tanya. Why wasn't it Marge Simpson?
Yeah. That would have been a great role for her. Or like, you know, she could have played a, I haven't seen a movie in 15 years.
Yeah. Wait, what are we talking about? Wait.
I don't know.
Oh, am I implying that Marge Simpson is not a cartoon character voiced by actress Julie Cavanier?
Yeah. She would have been great in the Jumanji reboot.
Yeah. But she's not The Rock.
No. She's Homer's Rock, though.
Well, her character is.
Yeah, that's true.
Back to The Simpsons. So Homer saying, or the or in question is at a yard sale. Which, that's probably a better place to get some used art a lot cheaper, you know, their stores. Yep. Yeah. The people that are having that yard sale are Kirk and Luann Van Houten. So I think in this timeline, they're back together, looks mm-hmm. like. We see Ralph there. So there's comic book guy, old Jewish man, and Otto there. Then they're looking through the crap at the Milhouse's family house. And so Homer's actually looking at Milhouse's junk. I mean, what? The stuff that they're trying to get rid of is like evidence that Milhouse's junk. As Homer's fondling Milhouse's junk.
Sure.
There's some used violins that Milhouse used to play. I don't remember him playing violin, but here he is. Has he played violin before?
I don't think so. Maybe.
No, because he plays that weird looking.
The weird horn thing.
That weird horn that Dewey Longer pointed out one episode.
Yeah.
He stopped. Well, the reason why I guess he plays that silly horn now is because Milhouse quit playing the violin because they discovered that vibrations were screwing up his bones.
Right.
So Homer wouldn't be interested in those violins because unfortunately someone has used a cello rosin on them instead.
That's embarrassing. I mean,
yeah,
they're clearly violins. You're going to make them all deep.
Fiddle-dee-dee.
Fiddle-dee-do. Marge, meanwhile, passes over glassware, exercise equipment, handmade doorknob koozies, and a Grammy, which got me wondering, did Can I Borrow a Feeling somehow make it big? Or did he, like, buy the B-Sharp's Grammy and is reselling it? I don't know. It's just funny that they had a Grammy in their yard.
I think it's the ever-growing joke that the Grammys are jokes.
Yeah, and they are.
Yeah, all award shows are.
Yeah, exactly. But she finds...
Except for the potties. Don't forget to vote for us for best TV
best, film. Yeah. Podcast. And best comedy podcast, if you're feeling real generous.
Best tragedy podcast?
There you go.
Best train wreck podcast. Yeah,
there yes. we go. Take that, Amy Schumer.
And Bill Hader.
Yes.
And Judd Apatow produced that.
Yeah.
Yeah, never saw it.
Yeah, it's fine. She wasn't train wrecky enough. Like, yeah, she just drank sometimes, and that was about it.
Yeah, well.
But anyway, Marge finds a painting depicting a rustic European seaside scene. Marge is instantly in love. She's never seen a painting with a lighthouse before. Luann explains that the picture hung on Kirk's bachelor pad when they were separated. Kirk would use
separated.
Especially with the offspring, Milhouse. Kirk would use the reflection of the chrome frame to shave, as he didn't own a mirror at that time. Marge begs her husband for $20 for the new living room painting, which is kind of sad. But Homer's found art of his own, a picture of a really rockin' jukebox. You know it's rockin' because music notes are coming out of it. Kirk sweetens the deal by throwing in those tiny violins.
That's such a 80s, 90s like memory for me. Like that, just like seeing that kind of picture that Homer has up. Mm-hmm. You have like the cool flamingo, or like it was always like a red sports car, but it wasn't like a name brand sports car. It just looked like red sports car with the zigzags. Like maybe like, all right, like Trapper Keepers. Kind of remember like Trapper Keepers too.
Totally, yeah. But also poster art, and there'd be like a babe sometimes or a hunk.
Well, yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like, you would go to like Spencer's, right? And you'd look at the poster section, and like most of the time it's like Pamela Anderson, right? And you're like, yeah, Pamela Anderson. And then it's Farrah Fawcett. Because it's still in there from the 70s.
Yeah.
Trying to think of like another 90s, like babes and bikini.
Cindy type. Crawford.
Yeah. Cindy Crawford. And then you'd get one that was like, then you get the one that had the rock and jukebox. You're like, what is this?
Yeah.
Like, who's going to buy this? To be like a grandma going and like, oh, get Billy. He wants a poster for Christmas. Like, oh, I don't think I'll get the babes, but this one will be fun for Billy.
Honestly, though, wouldn't you prefer to get a rocket jukebox for your grandma, not like a poster of a babe?
And then the grandma's like, I have the same one above my bed, too.
You can use it to masturbate like I do.
Hey, grandma, we get it. God.
Grandma loves babes. God.
I'm a babe magnet. I don't want to make a TV show called Babe Grandma Babe.
Yeah, just an old lady. I'm imagining like the classic old lady, like in a blue dress, gray hair. Yeah. And she's just like, I'm horny for babes.
Like, let's get, I know the go-to obviously is Betty White, but I don't think she's good for this. I think it should be, what's her name from, she was in that Nebraska movie.
Oh, yeah.
God, what is her name? It's like Jane, No, that's the movie, not the state, stupid computer. You should know better than that.
Who's the lady from Nebraska?
June Squibb. Squibb.
Yep. Yeah.
So it's June Squibb. And well, it's a sitcom. Like, we don't even like say like she's lesbian or anything like that.
No.
You don't need to, but it's still set in the 80s, and it's like there's gotta be more than her just like in babes though.
Yeah, maybe she can like play electric guitar or something. Yeah.
Wait, okay, here it is.
Okay.
This 12-year-old boy, 11, 12-year-old boy, he's visiting his grandma in the hospital because she's dying, and he makes a wish saying, like, I wish I give my life for yours, and as she's hugging, or as, like, they're holding hands, right?
Right.
Does a little Billy there know that that's exactly what's going to happen, because she has, like, this old ancient Incan tribal gem.
Yep, around her neck. Her husband brought it back from the war.
Yeah, in her paw. And so as he's like, your wish has come true. Or like, you know, just something happens and like
his... Yeah, like lightning flashes or something.
And his soul enters her. But unfortunately, she does pass on. But the 12-year-old boy is now an old lady.
And so does the body of the 12-year-old boy die? Because it's a body swap movie. And if she dies... I just imagine the soul going into the boy for briefly, and then all of a sudden the boy dies.
Okay, no, the boy body does die because the Freaky Friday thing happened like right when she's like flatlining, and so it transfers like automatically. So the 12-year-old is stuck as the grandma,
right?
But the grandma does die because her soul goes into the boy body, but it kills the boy too. They can't revive him.
Right. Okay.
So it's a dead 12-year-old.
Right.
So
that's a sad moment in this comedy. But then the next scene is like him going to the mall.
Well, no, it's, you know, he'll go and say like, but I am Billy, mom and dad, like all that kind of stuff. So like they, or, you know, he could keep it a secret. Maybe he'll keep it a secret. Anyways, yeah. But the idea is like, he's still going through puberty. So, but he has the hormones of a boy. So he's still a woman. So he'll get like ghost boners.
I like it. Yeah.
Oh, this is going to be an off the rails episode. All right.
Somebody get Orion Pictures on the phone.
No, this is a TV show.
Okay.
Yeah.
Somebody get Miller Boyette Productions.
Because each week it's, you know, a fun story, but it's an old lady, you know, pretending to be a 12-year-old boy, essentially.
Yeah.
That's all I'm asking for, Hollywood.
Come on, give us what we want.
But, and, you know, and it'll be funny because, like, he'll still have her friends, or his friends will be him. So it's just, you know, she hangs out with prepubescent boys and they talk about video games.
Yeah.
And, like, maybe. The series progresses when they start going through puberty, like, she'll have to start dating, like, little girls because that's who he's into. Because he's 14, so he wants to date a 14-year-old girl.
Right.
But, you know, but he's in an old lady body. He still has feelings, Steve.
It's true. Yeah.
Am I getting shut down?
Maybe you're breaking down. Although he could be like climbing the rope in gym class and all of a sudden has to stop because he gets a hot flash. I don't know how the puberty menopause thing would like connect with one another, but we'll figure it out.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
That's what writers are for.
Yeah, that's where we're hiring Rob LaZebnik for this show. It's gonna be great.
I think so.
Seriously, I think this show will work. Make it on Adult Swim. Like, you actually could do this.
Oh, yeah.
But like, oh, you'd be really good. It's like we film it as if it was an 80s sitcom.
Right. Yeah. So
we film. Yeah. So we make it like almost do. Okay. Maybe this is why I'm coming up with this, because I've been watching.
Yeah. Garth Marenghi's Dark Place.
Garth Marenghi's Dark Place. And so we'll just copy that same premise. Like, we'll film it now, but then do like, yeah, at the time we thought this would be a really funny show, but thinking about it now, very problematic.
Yeah.
And we'll just film it like, yeah, let's do it. All right, Steve.
All righty.
Let's just steal an idea that's already done. And we'll
sounds good.
We'll be right back.
Back at Evergreen Terrace on the TV show that we're watching, that we're 6 minutes into, Homer's using those tiny violins that he got from the garage sale as kindling for the fire. And he's adapted the bows from those violins to sticks for roasting marshmallows over the open flame. As Marge hangs her new painting, Homer shares his thoughts. They then make a discovery.
Oh, it looks great!
Well, to me it looks like garbage salad. But that's the great thing about art. Everyone can have their own opinion about why it sucks.
I've got to get rid of this ugly chrome frame from Kirk's bachelor pan. I hate to think of the things this mirror has reflected.
Hey, look, there's a signature that the frame covered up. Johann Oldenvelt. Here he is. Johann Oldenvelt, painter, lived in Amsterdam, Paris, prolific early 20th century naturalist. Oh, I think this was painted by someone famous. Maybe it's valuable.
We should have it appraised.
You guys are crazy. I never even heard of that guy. It's not like it was painted by Leonardo da Vinci code. Now, here's what makes art valuable. 1, nudity. 2, holograms. 3, something terrible happening to Jesus.
What year was this? 2014?
Yeah.
And we're still making lame Da Vinci Code jokes. Sorry.
Yep.
I know I'm not supposed to talk about negative things, but I just didn't think that joke was that good.
Yeah, I agree. It's not a good joke.
So that was 2014. Then they did the sequel. I'll just talk about besides the books, I'll talk about the movies, which is probably more recent, obviously. But
yeah,
like,
so
the first movie came in 2006, then 2009, Angels and Demons. So that's what, still a couple years after this
5 years, yeah.
And then did you know there was a third movie?
Really?
Yeah, called Inferno, which came out actually in 2016, so 2 years after this episode.
Did that have T. Hanks Anomaly too?
Oh, no, it had Felicity Jones.
Oh.
I don't know if it's the same character. I've never actually seen the movies or read the book, so.
Well, I have not either. I think Laura liked the first movie.
You don't have to ask her, Steve. It's fine.
Okay. Oh, yeah, and the chrome frame. Kirk would really masturbate. That's what Marge would see.
Oh, okay.
In case you're wondering. But Johann Oldenvelt is not actually a real painter, but they did write a very actually comprehensive Artopedia article that if you freeze the frame and zoom in, you can read it. I'm not going to bore you any more than I already am.
Thank you.
But the name Johann Oldenvelt might be inspired by Dutch statesman Johann van Oldenbarnevelt, who played a large role in the Dutch's struggle for independence from Spain. So there you go.
All right, you bored me.
Okay, I figured I would.
I switched over to the other podcast now. This airs on like radio, right?
Yeah. There's an empty nest podcast right on the other side of the dial.
Hey, guys.
We talk about that dog. I think there was a dog, like a golden retriever or something.
There's always a dog. Is there going to be a dog in our sitcom?
Oh, yeah. It'll be Spuds McKenzie.
Nice.
That's how we get the, that's how we hook people in. It's like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Before by Spuds McKenzie.
Yeah.
All right. Are they going to go to Gabblebee's Auction House, Steve?
Yeah. The famed tapped out location.
To get their piece appraised.
Ah, yes, seascape, marvelous natural light, classic use of gouache. You're right. This is an early career Oldenvelt, quite valuable.
Oh, my God.
I expect it to go somewhere between $80,000 to $100,000.
Nobody touch it. Bart, stop looking at it.
But I want to see it.
No, you'll wear it out. Baby, you saw something in this painting and you were right.
Wow, the Van Houtens owned this for years and never knew how much it was worth. Think how happy they'll be when we sell it and split the money with them.
Split it? Whoa,
Whoa. So Homer then continues his woes as they drive home with the painting safely buckled in the back seat with the seatbelt all buckled while all the rest of the children sit unharnessed.
So then he calls up his wife, Marge, while she's at the park, swinging a magazine on the swing set. And then he even has a Skywriter write a whoa, whoa, whoa three times in the air, pointing it out again.
Yeah, I didn't love the whoa. I get that the whole idea is that he's adamant about it, so he's saying whoa a lot, but didn't do it for me
either.
We go to our second act, which will surely be funnier, and it begins at the dinner table of the Simpsons. The painting is chained to a chair, and Homer continues to say whoa even more as he and Marge debate the ethics of splitting their money from the artwork. Marge feels that Kirk and Wan didn't know the value of the work, and Homer feels that since they sold it to him, he can keep it on the wall, cut eye holes in it to spy on people, or sell it for lots of money that they can keep for themselves. Bart gets it.
I do like how Homer actually refers to Marge as that dude gets it.
Yeah, that was fun.
Funny. Later that evening, Homer is skimming the latest issue of a pretending to read magazine and bread there. I do like the pretending to read magazine. That's kind of funny.
Yeah.
And Marge continues to her attempt to convince Homer to be Spike Lee's greatest film, Do the Right Thing.
Oh, I thought it was going to be Girl 6.
But the Van Houtens are our friends.
Are they, Marge? If you think about it, aren't they really just the parents of a kid who happens to hang out with our kid?
All our friends are like that. Well, how would you feel if we sold them something that turned out to be valuable?
I would feel A, happy for their good fortune, B, proud to know rich people, and C, grateful for an opportunity to learn from a mistake.
How about this? What if we give the Van Houtens 25% of the money?
Then they'll just be mad about the 65% that we're keeping. Marge, you like kindness, right?
Sure.
So even if we gave Kirk and Luann some of the money, the knowledge of what they could have had will eat away at them, like piranhas devouring a wounded yeti. It's kinder never to tell them.
Okay, I see your point. We should sell the painting, keep all the money, and never, ever tell the Van Houtens.
The yeti thing was kind of funny.
Was it, Steve?
I guess it wasn't. I'm lying to myself.
Okay.
Like I do every day. Anyway, just then, they hear a deep inhale. They looked up to see Milhouse sitting in the treehouse, taking a hit of his asthma inhaler. And so as Bart and Milhouse are playing with the army men, Homer asks his son's best friend what it'll take to keep his silence. And as everyone knows, the best way to keep a young boy's mouth shut is to buy them toys. So they head to Toys Be This, which I'm going to stop right now. We had a Toys R Us thing last week.
Yeah, Oys R Us.
Yeah, which was problematic for a different reason. Mm-hmm. Toys Be This is just lazy to me.
Yeah. Haven't they already probably done a Toys R Us type store?
Yeah, I think so.
Parody, I don't know what it is, but apparently it wasn't that good because they had to change it up.
Yeah. So they fill a shopping cart from Milhouse, which consists of a new puppy Goo Goo and action figures from Blob Jitsu and Planet Jackson, which is it was a nice callback because we talked about those at some point in the show, and even a shiny new bike. Bart and Lisa look on clearly annoyed. All these toys are for Milhouse, and all he has to do is not mention the painting to his parents. So Marge reasons with the young boy.
Oh, sweetie, you want your parents to be happy, don't you?
I guess.
You're funny. No wonder Lisa's in love with you.
She is?
She is.
So if I keep my mouth shut, you get me new wheelie sneakers, and Bart agrees to promote and encourage use of my new cool nickname, CJ.
You got it, Siege.
You found out that painting was worth big bucks, and you weren't gonna tell us?
I don't know what you're talking about. Hide the treasure.
I'm sorry, Mr. S. I cracked.
We had a deal, and now we've got nothing.
We considered you our friends. We trusted you. I let Homer use our master bathroom. Then you stab us in the back.
You know, I gotta say, Homer's kind of smart in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
He has some good ideas, logical ones. He doesn't really do anything stupid, I don't think.
It's true.
He'll say, put holes in a painting, but that's just fine. But, I mean, the way in that scene, he was pretty quick on the gun there with when Mouse was figuring out, you know, pulling the Lisa's in love with you, like using that to their advantage.
Right. And then bribing Bart and Lisa with the Malibu Stacy and the new Nerf gun.
Also, I demand you start calling me CJ, Steve. I think it sounds better.
I think you could be a CJ.
I mean, I have a C. I don't have a J, though, in my name.
Seems like you may have had a J before.
There we go, man. That's why I'm CJ.
And because you're a good communicator, just like CJ Craig from the West Wing. Yeah.
Well, there you go. I like the West Wing.
Yeah.
We'll call you HJ.
HJ.
CJ and HD. Okay.
I did think the visual of Homer blowing Bart or Milhouse with the wheelies, that was fun.
It was a callback because Homer bought those wheelies for him.
Exactly. Nothing looks more annoying or makes me feel like an old man than when I see children.
I was thinking that. Like in the grocery store, I was like, yeah. I'm like, damn hooligans.
They just roll like 10 feet and like, what are you doing?
Yeah, they should be on a leash.
Yeah. This is a very anti-kid episode.
I always think about that. We talk about a family sitcom, yet we both don't have families.
Yeah.
All right, let's talk about this family more.
All righty. Homer then pokes Marge, causing her to offer an argument to the Van Houtens. If they could have sold such a valuable painting for so little, how could they live with themselves? Homer and Marge were just trying to be kind. Kirk and Luann feel as though giving them nothing is less than kind, but Homer counters that he wanted to take them to dinner at an upscale restaurant and never explained why, but not anymore. Kirk and Homer agree that that is exactly how it is. Marge asks if Luann still wants to meet up to collect used cell phones for the troops on Thursday. I don't know what that means.
They're going to hang out.
Okay. Luann declines, figuring that Marge can do it herself since she's so good at collecting things. This harsh insult causes Marge to nearly faint and Homer to react as though he was sarcastically freezing since her remark was so cold.
So in the kitchen, Marge is troubled by the greed caused by the painting and Homer has something to show his wife. He opens his wallet and pulls out an ATM receipt from the First Bank of Springfield. And we did some zoom and enhance there. Apparently, it's from August 7th at 4:23 p.m. It's just almost coming up, Steve.
Yeah.
Homer doesn't know who it belongs to, but he found it next to the ATM. And he's always held onto it. And he directs Marge to look at the balance. It's got five figures.
Woo.
And with that painting, they could have what the people with the five figures have, a money cushion. So no more living to Homer says no more living to paycheck, one lost retainer away from the gutter. We could even write a check with the days on today's date on it. Well, ooh. I mean, not, I mean, his today day.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I guess he could write today's date that we record. I just don't know that he's.
Yeah. I mean, that would be like seven years into the future.
Yeah. Anyways, but that's the cushion, Steve. That's the cushion.
Cushion's a good feeling.
I have a cushion.
I've got a cushion for the pushing.
Yeah. We're talking about our derriers, right?
Right. Exactly.
Okay, good. I don't have money.
No, but I got a fat ass. Yeah. That'll make me some money.
Yeah.
I do not have a fat ass. I have a very small. I have a Hank Hill ass.
You do have a Hank Hill ass.
I know. Later that evening.
You have a back and a legs, and that's it.
Yeah. I've got a beer gut. I'm like a potato with two toothpicks.
Yep.
Later that evening, the family are in the living room. Maggie's playing with blocks. Lisa is attending to her guinea pig habitat. And Homer is clutching the painting tightly. They are all focused as the TV airs a very special report.
Tonight, a special report. Fat cat art experts take advantage of John and Jane yard sale. So, would you characterize your friend of many years cheating you out of your painting as no big deal or a devastating betrayal?
Oh, definitely betrayal, Kent.
Interesting. So if you see the Simpsons walking down your street, lock your doors and hide your friendship.
Great, now we're raccoons, the masked bandits of the animal world.
Don't worry, no one's gonna see this stupid show.
Give back the painting. The whole town's turned against us.
You have no obligation to share the money from that painting.
Ooh, a support rock!
I do like the fact that there's support rocks.
Yeah.
People keep throwing. It's funny to me. It's very funny.
Somebody who had such a strong opinion that you don't have to share the money.
Yeah.
To actually feel the need to let them know, let alone with a rock.
That's great.
Also in that clip, the Chiron changed several times. And there's some fun ones. There's the Great Frame Robbery, Brush with Hateness, Friendship Van Gone, The Art of War and The War of Art.
Were these actually all like titles for this episode, like they were pitching around the writer's studio? Yeah. Because they all would make sense for Simpsons episodes, really.
It's true. I mean, Brush with Hateness worked great for this episode. The frame does play a part in it, so the great frame robbery.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, several rocks with notes taped to them fly through the Simpsons window. They divide them up. There's a pile that's against them, and there's a pile that's for them. And they got more rocks than Christmas cards, so that's good.
Yeah.
And outside the auction house, two angry mobs have formed. One side feels, as Sideshow Bob, so Sideshow Mel puts it, their masterpiece thievers. And representing the other side is our favorite bartender, Mo.
Ah, shut your bone hole. That painting belongs to the Simpsons.
Sharing is what makes a community strong.
All sales are final.
Capers! Find this capers, moron!
You really think we're still doing the right thing?
Just close your eyes and think of the cushion.
I like Shut Your Bone Hole a lot. As all the eyes watch them, Marge and Homer walk in to put the painting up for auction. The opening bid is $80,000, which elicits several wealthy people, including Rainier Wolfcastle, to raise their paddles. Kirk and Luann have paddles of their own, one that reads bad and the other that says friends, so it says bad friends. Marge writes sorry in cursive on her paddle, while Homer pens losers. Just then, someone rushes in to put a stop to that sale.
You know, Marge writing bad friends, she could have just wrote season 9 and 10.
That's true. Bad friends.
Season 8 through 10, maybe?
Yeah.
What's the one? Was it season 9 when Rachel dates Joey?
Yeah, that's kind of like the demarcation of when it got really bad. All right. Gets a little exhausting in general after a while, though.
I haven't rewatched it in years, so I don't really care.
You're fine.
Anyways, clip.
Stop the auction! That painting belongs to me!
Dawn!
Good to see you again, Beef Kirky.
Who is this woman?
While you two were separated, Kirk and I used to be friends with Banana Fitz.
Mm. You told me you didn't see anyone during our separation.
Madam, are you saying this painting belongs to you?
Kirk stole it from me, but I didn't know it was valuable till I saw the story on TV.
What? I bought that painting. She's lying.
The auction is on hold until we can determine the true ownership.
Percussion!
Don't bother coming home, Kirk.
Oh,
see what your greed has done? Ow.
Anybody want to give me a ride home? Going once? Going twice?
Sold to the lonely auctioneer.
Is Kirk hung? Does he have a huge hog?
What makes you think that, Craig?
Because she comes in and calls him Beef Kirky.
Okay.
So like beef, thick beef, you know.
Right.
And then what was the banana thing she said?
Oh, yeah. Friends with Banana Fits.
Friends with Banana Fits. But that doesn't make sense. Like, is it implying that, like, I think he's well endowed, Steve.
Huh, maybe.
You think banana? I don't know.
Could be. I mean, maybe he's packing a lot between his legs.
Hey, tell us what you think if Kirk's got a huge hog at POTUS at whitehouse.gov.
Yeah. And if you want to draw a rendering of what you think it might look like, please do that as well.
Yeah. At Steve from the Simpsons podcast at gmail.com.
Steve from the Simpsons podcast at gmail.com. Yeah.
It's a really clunky email you have there.
I know. I just didn't want any numbers in there.
Yeah.
I love Hung Daddy Kirk's and his face getting red.
That is so good. Yeah,
it was really good.
Not the only thing that's getting red.
I also enjoyed the auctioneer because he then carries Don out of the building as the attendees of the auctioneer cheer on like it's an officer and a gentleman, like yay. And our third act begins with Kirk squatting on the Simpsons couch. Homer feels fully responsible as Kirk is saddened that he'll never stare at Luann's thick eyeglasses through his thick eyeglasses. Again, that's not the only thing that's thick. Homer then offers support and some Canadian duff, or Le Duff Beer avec Codeine, or beer with codeine, which sounds delightful.
Oh, that would like be the best. Like, you feel so good.
I know.
You just drift off into beer sleepy heaven.
Mm,
you wake up, you're fine. If you don't wake up ever, even better.
Yep, it's a win-win, baby. And that beer features Duff Man saying, "Oh yeah," dressed as a Mountie, or "May we," for the French-speaking alcoholics from the Great White North.
Steve, I may we after drinking all those Canadian beers.
It's a fair point.
So Kirk then tells Homer that he and Donna purchased that painting while on vacation in a resort called Isla Verde. He bought the painting in a cafe, and that night Don hooked up with the parasailing instructor. Anyways, Don never actually owned the painting, but she'd say anything to keep herself in electric cigarettes. Kirk would be willing to get back to the cafe, but fears that nothing would win Luann back. And all this information gives Homer an idea, which he shares with his wife.
Okay, all I gotta do is take a quick ferry to Isla Verde, find Cafe Artiste, and they'll back up Kirk's story. That will prove the painting was his and now ours.
Oh, Homer Simpson, that painting has torn the town apart, destroyed Kirk and Luann's marriage, and everyone's very worried about Milhouse.
He's been playing Dancing Revolution for hours, but the TV is off.
Creepy.
Creepy.
Mailhouse is dancing there.
Yep. Did you ever play the
VR?
No. Okay.
It seems exhausting.
Yeah, it is.
Back in the day, I did have the power pad for the NES.
Very cool. You have all of the games that that was compatible with?
I had two. There was the one that you get, which is the track and field.
Uh-huh.
And then like some weird like cop game that called Street Cop. And I think there's only like three or four levels. But
yeah,
I would actually beat it all the time as one of the few games I could.
Well, that's fun.
Challenging though. Challenging to get that last bad guy.
I'd imagine. You give me an exercise too. It's
yep.
Great.
Well, no, there was a way where you just like you sat on the floor and you used your hands to hit the paddles. Like I'm hitting the microphone right now. Sorry.
Cool. If only there was like a handheld device that would also control your...
Exactly.
And let's make it rectangular so it pinches your fingers.
Yep.
Wouldn't it take 20 years to realize that you could contour plastic? Milhouse steps on the dance pad while staring dead-eyed into the mic screen. Marge feels that this picture has brought out the worst in everyone and just wants Homer to let it go. She storms off and Homer thinks that he has no choice. So he hops on a ferry, an express ferry, from Springfield to Isla Verde. Along with him for the ride is Lisa, who's quite excited. Homer tells her that if Marge asks, they're going to go to a wine tasting. And Lisa says that's a terrible thing to do, which is exactly why Marge will believe it.
So the art community that was once quite quaint has now been tainted by tourism. Nothing but discos and gelato places, as far as the eye could see. So Homer, Lisa, and Pokey go to a vendor selling worm Speedos. And they're seeking to find a cafe artiste. The polite swimwear salesman directs them up the hill, three discos up, four gelatos on the left. It's right between the disco and the gelato place. You can't miss it. And after many scoops of gelato Homer has there, they arrive at their destination.
Welcome to Cafe Artiste. Would you like a glass of Strupo? It's a liqueur made of fermented capers, the official drink of the island.
Sounds delicious. It's not. Hey, a friend of mine bought a painting here.
Oh, yes. I remember that painting. And that is the man I sold it to.
And that man sold it to me. That proves the painting is mine. And nothing can stop me from selling it and keeping all the money. I love art.
Art? What do you know about art? You don't even know who painted that picture.
Yes, we do. It's a Johann Oldenveld.
Wrong. It's a me.
What?
I painted it. Me. Klaus Ziegler.
Who?
Klaus Ziegler. Come on. Jeez. Pay attention, guys.
Do you know who Klaus Ziegler is?
Toby's brother. The astronaut.
A weird plot point.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the last season. Sucked. That joke of when he's drinking the Strupo, when Homer says, like, it sounds good, and drinks it, kind of breaks the fourth wall and is like, it's not. Like, that just, like, just to me reminded me of Peter Griffin. Like, that was such a Family Guy moment. Like, that would be a joke.
Because it kind of stops everything, too. Like,
yeah.
It's like, it's not.
Because it kind of looks like he doesn't, but it just seems like he is breaking the fourth wall.
Yeah.
And sometimes on the show, we like to eat or drink things that are on the episode. So, Steve, I bought you some Strupo here.
Alrighty.
Here you go.
It sounds delicious, honestly. Take a little sip here. And it is.
Well, Steve, I'll let you know that Strupo's not real.
Aw.
Yeah, I just gave you pickle juice.
Aw, I hate that. I love it.
Nothing cures a hangover like pickle juice.
No, thank you.
Hey, that voice sounded familiar, Steve. Do you know who that was?
What do you tell me?
Okay. It was forever old man Max von Sydow.
Max von Sydow.
Even as a kid, I always thought he was 90 years old.
I know.
Well, because they gave him old makeup face in
The Exorcist?
Exorcist, yeah. So maybe that was it. But then he looked like old, scary old man in Strange Brew.
Mm-hmm. Flash Gordon.
He was in everything. We just recently passed, lost him a couple years ago, right?
Yeah, I think so.
So he's voicing Klaus Ziegler there. Sorry you didn't die sooner. We could do this whole tribute episode for you, Max, but here we are. So Klaus takes them to the studio where he painted the so-called Oldenveld. For proof, the painter holds up an empty frame to the window, perfectly composing the seascape from the painting. And Homer lets out an, "Aw, crap!" And Lisa calls their new acquaintance a forger.
Oh, no.
So if Strupo is not real, Steve, what is there anything that would, instead of pickle juice, what would it be like, you think?
Yeah, I mean, making a liqueur out of capers would be really weird. But there is a aperitif or a liqueur called Cynar or Canar. I never know how to say it. I've heard other bartenders say it different ways, but it's made from artichokes.
Oh, I think Canar is a Cardassian drink from Star Trek Deep Space Nine, Steve. Jeez.
With their big butts and their
Instagrams.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cardassians.
Yeah. All right. So do we have a clip?
I think we do. It's about forging.
Forger is such a cruel word. I'm an art forger. Your painting was an early clumsy effort which I gave to the cafe owner to pay off my Strupo tab.
Then why did the auction house say it was real?
I have fooled galleries around the world with my loving imitations. Siegler, 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 Siegler.
What you do is horrible, ripping off geniuses who spent years perfecting their styles.
Perhaps you are the one who is horrible.
What?
You only cared about that painting when you thought it was created by someone famous.
Well, no, but now, when I look at it, all I see is a fraud.
Beauty is beauty. My forgeries give pleasure to people all over the world. The only real question to ask about art, whether it's in the Louvre or on a freshman's wall at Cal State Fullerton, is, did it move you?
Ooh.
Did it move you, Steve?
To a bigger house? Gosh, crap, I said the loud part quiet. I didn't see the quiet part at all.
Lots of things going on there, Steve.
Yes. So obviously we have, you know, the beautiful sentiment about Toby Ziegler's brother's sentiment about art and how if you're inspired by it, it doesn't matter the value of it. And so Lisa's kind of a jerk. But also we have a lot of people enjoying art, including Ralph in a museum. And then Saddam Hussein, who is, I don't know if that's Saddam Hussein, but he was long dead by this point, right?
I think you're right. I could look it up, but I don't need to.
Yeah, he died in 2006. So I don't know if it's supposed to be him or somebody else, but he's in his bedroom petting a lion and there's art behind him. And then two guards at the auction house, so enchanted with the seascape that they hold hands, which I thought was sweet. And then, of course, there's the elephant in the room, or the rich guy in space, because it's Richard Branson, and he's floating in space just like he did recently. And, of course, everybody on the internet had to say, Simpsons did it, Simpsons did it.
Oh, were they?
Oh, yeah.
Well, you know, because he's, I've been saying it for years, but, you know, it takes time, obviously, to prep that kind of thing.
Right.
Which, I mean, yeah, it is a topic. We're not a political podcast.
Yeah, not a political podcast.
Yeah. I mean, you know, those rich guys do whatever they want with their money. It's fine.
Yeah, because they couldn't do anything else better with it. Like,
solving the
crime crisis. And, not a political podcast.
No. Hey, Dolly Parton is never a billionaire because she gives all of her money to... She put $1 million just to help us get the vaccine. All right.
Yeah.
Dolly should be going to space.
Yep. So we can preserve her. Everybody should be more like Dolly Parton.
Right. Okay. Well, Lisa's speech, left speechless there. She's come to the conclusion that Klaus is actually right. And Homer wonders about himself. He's never liked the painting in the first place and only wanted it for the money. Klaus respects Homer's honesty, so the painting is worthless. So the trip was pointless, and Marge is going to kill Homer. But Klaus may have a solution. If art is good for one thing, it's to melt the frost, which often hardens a woman's heart. Before Klaus begins to paint, Homer requests a few more pieces, and offering a Strupo as payment.
Yeah, Klaus really likes that Strupo.
Yeah.
We then see that he's created a family portrait of the Van Houtens, which, causes Luann to forgive Kirk.
Mm-hmm.
He also recreated the classic sailboat painting, which Homer gives to Marge. She finds it to be perfect art. She hangs it on the wall, and next to it, Homer hangs up his perfect art, that rockin' jukebox.
Does that mean from here on out, there'll be the jukebox and the sailboat on Simpsons episodes?
I would assume so, yeah.
All right.
Yeah. And, you know, we can see Pokey every week. Maybe all of his adventures.
Exciting. Well, Steve, Homer, Marge, they share a hug and the credits roll. That's it.
Well, actually, Craig,
I see that.
The text of the credits were written in white instead of their usual yellow, which means, you know what that means. We're going to get a little something extra.
All right. Prove me wrong.
So text on screen shows Strupo, a history. We see various posters as Klaus Ziegler offers various names for the liquor.
The Grey Troll, it's a poster showing a grey demon troll holding a bottle of Strupo, all surrounded by capers.
And we have the Brine of Madness, and that poster shows a dapper little caper in a bowler and a cane, and he's wielding a knife.
And then Angel's Urine, and we see three cherubs pissing into a bottle of Strupo. That's great.
These were all the names of the mysterious caper beverage, originally used to dissolve seagull corpses, as displayed by Homer, Lenny, and Carl. Ziegler then goes on to say that to local alcoholics, it was a palatable drink for the last resort. We then see Homer with a devil oozing out of his nose as Klaus describes the powerful hallucinations, and then the gender confusion in Wandering Mouth, which shows his mouth on his forehead. So if you visit Isla Verde, be sure to say ahoy to the crushing addiction of Strupo. Strupo, lose everything.
We then see the devil, the urinating angels, and the dapper caper floating with the menace over a skeleton. And that's it, Steve. It's finally over. Right. All right. How about we collect our thoughts and our tots and take a break and come back and wrap it up.
That sounds good. If you wrap it up in the first place, you don't have those tots. We'll be right back.
Strupo, lose everything.
And we're back. Steve, welcome back from the break. Let's break down this episode, The War of Art. We'll talk about some of our favorite moments. We'll talk about if there's anything from this episode we want branded on a shirt or tattoo. And then we'll find out what we're watching next week. And we'll give our thoughts, I guess.
Sounds
and then we'll,
great.
And then we'll watch next week.
Then what?
Then we'll say bye.
Okay, sounds good.
All right, we like to start off with some merchandise and branding, something to make some Robert De Niro's. Or you just De Niro's.
Yeah.
To put on a shirt or a tattoo or a poster or whatever, whatever. Action figures. I don't care.
Yeah. So
what do you got for us?
Well, Craig, for my bad grandpa making thing to carry on that Robert De Niro bit, I pretty much just have one. And it's clean and direct. It's a t-shirt. It's the last frame of the episode. And it's just the devil, a caper, and three angels pissing on a skull. That's only a bottle of Grupo.
Make that a print, and we can put it in and replace the sailboat painting.
There we go. Yeah.
That whole actually all those title cards or one-off arts would be great as like.
Oh yeah.
We've talked about like enamel pins or like a trading card set, but maybe like just art prints, you know?
Yeah, it just reminds me of like when you're like moving into your apartment for the first time and you want art for the wall.
I was thinking, right? That's weird.
Yeah. And you get like the old timey liquor bottles, but you're like 18 and you don't know what any liquor is.
Yeah.
So you do like, buy a Cynar.
And then there's like the ballerina that's twirling spaghetti or something.
Right. And there's a parrot holding a globe.
Yeah. Are you making fun of the first time I moved out my apartment? I
mean, everybody does it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you're right. So just get all those prints and then it's art.
Yeah. What about you, Craig? What would your thing would it, be?
Well, maybe the beginning there with the meth high fighting tweakers.
Oh yeah, that was a fun drawing. I liked it a lot.
Yeah, just make it like a jersey or you know like the colleges with the sports shirts.
Yeah, like the extra large like athletic club shirts.
Yeah, those ones. Yeah.
Yeah, Heather Gray.
Like that. Okay.
Yeah, I think that's good. You could also go with the hamster shirts that Lenny and Carl wear.
Of course.
But I think we got the good ones.
Oh, we got the goods.
Oh yeah.
All right. What about favorite scene or joke?
Huh.
Got, I think Marge might have been maybe. I don't know if she might be in my MVJ.
Yeah.
I think there's some fun stuff that she talks about in the beginning. I'm trying to think now what it was. Maybe not Marge. I mean, the auctioneer and Kirk's ex-lover were pretty fun.
Yeah, I thought that was fun. I thought the Ken Brockman bit was pretty okay.
It's always fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's fun hearing Max von Sydow.
Yeah. Hmm. Not a joke, but his sentiment about art to me is probably my quote for the episode. And I think that we're finding this recently that maybe the quote that we like isn't the funniest one, but the most poignant one.
Right. Yeah. I think Homer had some poignant art quote too. It was like,
it was about the garbage salad and about how.
Oh, wait, garbage salad. That's my favorite line.
Yeah.
That's garbage a good line. Salad.
That's the great thing about art. Everyone can have their own opinion about why it sucks.
There you go. I like that quote. That's poignant for me.
Yeah. and it's like
a podcast.
Exactly. You can all find reasons why you don't like it. You don't have to jump on other people's.
No, we're not talking about The Simpsons. Talking about our podcast that sucks.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Cool.
But
why it sucks is your own discovery, because we've got a lot of reasons to hate our podcast. So just have to find the one that's right for you.
Probably yes.
Yeah, probably.
All of it. Yeah. Let's just get into it, Steve. How about that?
Yeah. You alluded to earlier in the episode about what the moral right thing to do is. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on who was in the right or who was in the wrong.
I would say, honestly, I think Homer is, if you think about it. Like, I think it's something like, I sold you a book for $20, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you go and you find out that the book is somewhat rare and it's worth like $200. Now, $200 is a lot of money, but it's also not a lot of money.
Sure.
So if I found out that it was that book that, you know, I undersold you, it was $200, but then you sold it for $200, I wouldn't expect you to give me $200 or half that or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to something like this, it's bigger and you send, you know, I mean, Homer, I think, is in the right, but I think the decent, I don't know.
Yeah, it's dicey because I think from not necessarily a legal standpoint, but from a non-emotional standpoint, you're right that Homer is correct because there were services sold.
Yep.
Transaction was done. And whatever happens after that transaction is none of your.
Yeah. You know. But I think the point I was making is like, if it was worth like millions of dollars, you know, that book instead of $200 or whatever, right? That I sold you. I feel like maybe it would be weird to be. I personally think I'd be weirded out by like, I have millions of dollars.
Yeah.
I didn't know about it. I would, you know, like my life is now 100% different, you know?
Right. And I think that there should be an action for the Van Houtens. Like they should, like if they sold the painting, they did make like $100,000.
Yeah.
They should.
Homer said they were going to take him to a upscale chain restaurant.
Right. So, you know.
That's like what PF Chang's, right?
Yeah. That's like $80.
Yeah. That's worth it.
But yeah, then the question becomes, how much do you give them? Like, because if you give too little, it just seems like an insult. But I mean, half seems like too much to me.
I think half is too much. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and I don't think we'll ever be in this position. So that's good.
Yeah. I do like there's a little joke about how Marge suggested that they give them 25%, which I think is reasonable. And Homer's like, well, then we only get 65%. Yeah. So there's the one instance of Homer being dumb in this episode. Good.
Yeah. All in all, I think the episode, I'll just say it's a miss for me.
Yeah.
I just kind of felt weird about like the whole Lisa, like wanting the guinea pig thing. Like, she's also the most trustworthy, like Simpsons in person out there. Like why would like they hesitate about getting her a pet? I don't know.
Yeah.
It just seemed like maybe Rob LaZebnik wrote this script. This was a Evening Shade script he wrote. Mm-hmm. Empty Nest, not Evening Shade.
Right.
Maybe it was an Evening Shade.
Yeah, Richard Mulligan is like, adult daughter, I don't know if you're ready to get a guinea pig. Couldn't even keep that marriage going.
Yeah, exactly. And they're like, Rob, I don't know if this is going to work. All right, I'll keep my guinea pig script for something later on with, I don't know, a comedian, Greg Giraldo. Okay, Greg, in this case, you have to try a person who wants a guinea pig.
You're out of order. This guinea pig's out of order.
Off on that tangent there. But yeah, I don't know. Like, I don't think I really chuckled once in this episode. Now, I'm not saying that's, again, I don't like disparaging art,
mm-hmm.
which is what this episode is. So like, maybe it is like, maybe this episode's good for someone, but I mean, I like the message. I thought this had a nice moral. Just don't think the jokes landed. That's it.
Yeah.
And it's a good morality tale.
Yeah. And if you had to give it a rating.
Did we do that on the show?
I mean, kind of.
How many paintings are there in the world?
Let's see if I can name them all. There's the dogs playing poker.
One.
American Gothic.
Two. Screaming Dude.
Screaming Dude, yeah.
Three.
There's the the naked guy is a statue, not a painting.
All right, so three.
Yeah, okay, three.
I'll say out of three. One out of three.
One out of three.
One out of three, or 0.5. You know what? I'll give this 10% out of the 100% that Homer was trying to add up.
That's fair. Yeah. Let me tell you what.
Whoa.
Let me tell you, Greg. What worked for me in this episode, I really enjoyed Marge and Homer debating the ethics of their quagmire. Giggity. I think that what they were talking about was very interesting. And I didn't mention it, but I think my MBJ might actually be the hamster, the guinea pig lady, just because her enthusiasm in the voice was very fun. And the phrase bumblefoot or the slobbers as possible diseases, I thought that was a fun turn of phrase. I liked garbage salad. I liked shut your bone hole. I also like that throughout the episode, Homer doesn't like the painting in question. And he's not a jerk about it, but he just doesn't hesitate in bringing up that, like, it's not for me. And so I thought that was a nice running thing. But you're right, there aren't a lot of, like, hilarity. There's not a lot of hilarity in this episode. It's not a lot of jokes. But it does bring up some fun moral ethical questions. And I think the set piece is fun, but the episode isn't fun. And it feels like, you're right, it doesn't feel like a Simpsons episode in a weird way.
Yeah, it does feel like an 80s, 90s, like, family sitcom, Full House or something, right?
Right.
Like, when they've done, didn't, like, Michelle get a goldfish and they kept dying? And
mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, this is a very run-of-the-mill family sitcom story.
Yeah, it's a very sitcom-y thing. And so, you know, most sitcoms nowadays are about 22 minutes. So I'm going to say of 22 minutes, this is like a 7.
All right. 7 out of 11.
Slurpee.
Or
20. No, yeah, this was also just a miss for me. It wasn't, just didn't have that, like, great feeling. It's not horrible. I think you can skip it, though.
I think it's a skip for me. But you would say you like it more than me.
Slightly, yeah.
No, you would say you like it more than me.
I like it more than you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Proving that you would say that.
I would say that.
Definitely a skip.
Well, what you don't want to skip is next week's episode, where we watch a different episode. And to do that, we need to find out which episode we're watching. And so to do that, we need that good old Wheel of Random. Let's give it a spin to see what season we're in. Ba-doop.
We have season 16.
Season 16. All right, let's give it another spin to see which episode we're watching. Ba-doop.
Woohoo! Episode 12.
Season 16, episode 12. Why, that's Goo Goo Guy Pan. What happens, Craig?
In this episode, Selma, that's Marge's sister,
mm-hmm.
also Patty's sister, Selma decides to adopt a child. And to do that, the entire Simpsons family is going to China.
Oh.
Do you remember this episode, Steve?
I do. I don't remember the ins and outs of it, but I do remember kind of the whole story about it.
Yeah, I think it's also, isn't it a controversial episode? I know it's banned in China.
Yeah, there is a lot of controversy. Also, it's a little autobiographical because the it was written by Dana Gould under the
Gould
under the pseudonym Lawrence Talbot. But yeah, because he had similar experiences with his own life adopting a child from China.
Yep. So I do remember this one, and I guess I need a refresher though, so I will watch it next week, Steve.
I think I will too.
Under protest, of course.
Of course. Hell no, we won't go.
Come back next week. And in the meantime, you can go and contact us on social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook at 138Simpsons.
And you can always email us at 138Simpsons@gmail.com. And if you're so kind, go to your favorite podcatching app and leave us 5 stars or the equivalent. But it doesn't need to be a real review. You can just write what you think Kirk's hog looks like. Yeah.
You're stumbling on a Kirk's hog there, Steve. So was I.
it's so big, it's hard not to.
Yeah. All right, for this week, I've been an annoyed grunt boy, Craig.
And I've been an annoyed grunt boy, Steve.
And remember, keep borrowing a feeling.
And shut your bone hole.
What you do is horrible. Ripping off geniuses who spent years perfecting their styles.